After over a decade of struggle, the back end of 1982 seemed to be where Allan Holdsworth was really hitting his stride, both musically and commercially. Selling out huge venues in California and shifting thousands of copies of his independent debut album, I Owe You, via mail order and at gigs all over the USA. And with a new mini-album, Road Games, plus a multi-album deal with Warner Brothers on the horizon, the world was his oyster. Or so it seemed at that point. In this video, we'll be exploring the making of Allan's 1983 EP or mini-album, Road Games. Our story picks up right where we left off in the last video. And as a quick refresher, Allan had finally gotten his dream band together in the UK, consisting of Holdsworth, Gary Husband on drums, Paul Carmichael on bass, and Paul Williams on vocals. The band, known as IOU, was struggling to gain any momentum in England, and after a risky move to the States, became an overnight sensation due to the cult status Holdsworth had achieved there in the late 1970s. During this period, Allan caught the ear of Eddie Van Halen, who, after jamming with the band on stage at the Roxy in early 1982, was so enamoured by Holdsworth's playing and shocked at the seeming lack of interest from record labels in who he believed to be the best guitarist he'd ever heard. And after hearing about how much Allan had struggled to get his band a debut album off the ground, Eddie Van Halen decided that he would be the one to jumpstart Allan's career. Eddie then invited Van Halen's longtime producer, Ted Templeman, down to see the band with the hope that he would consider signing Allan to Warner Brothers. The date was May 11th, 1982, and Van Halen and Templeman, fresh off producing Van Halen's 1982 album Diver Down, headed down to the Reseda Country Club to catch IOU in full flight. Ted Templeman recalls of the evening, "He was amazing, of rare talents with a unique voice on the instrument. He was one of the very best guitarists I've ever seen in my life. He didn't have the musicality, the ability to write anything from pop to hard rock that Ed and Clapton had. But as a soloist, he was untouchable. I didn't love everything about his band, but as far as I was concerned, I was there to scout Allan. I talked to him after the show and said I'd like to get him on Warner Brothers and produce him. He was enthusiastic. Soon after, I signed him to a multi-album deal. Ed was ecstatic, maybe even happier than Allan. The wheels were now in motion for what was to be Allan's major label debut. But sadly, internal problems within the band were threatening to destroy the group long before they could get anywhere near a recording studio. The move to the States, although totally right for Allan's career, proved to be challenging for Gary Husband and Paul Carmichael, creating huge pressure within the band, with the pair deciding to return to England in August 1982. With only Paul Williams remaining, Allan set about forming the next incarnation of the IOU band. Replacing Paul Carmichael would be Allan's old Bruford bandmate, Jeff Berlin, with whom Allan had worked on the first two Bruford albums, Feels Good to Me and One of a Kind. This was a match made in heaven, as far as I'm concerned, as the pair had proven chemistry together, with Jeff being easily capable of keeping Allan on his toes, trading intricate licks and solos, and dazzling all of the bass players in the audience. Taking over from Gary Husband was a young Chad Wackerman, who was at the time on a break from playing with Frank Zappa when he first auditioned for the IOU band. This audition was unlike any audition Chad had ever been to, as rather than ask any of the auditionees to learn pieces, the two spent the entire hour and a half audition just improvising together. Chad later asked Allan why he didn't have any of the auditionees prepare his old songs to learn, and Allan replied that anybody can learn the tune and play it back. He was more interested in how it felt to improvise with them and to see what new and interesting flavours they would be able to add to Allan's compositions. With the new lineup of IOU now complete, the band set off in an old beat-up Cadillac and a U-Haul trailer on a tour of the States, preparing material for the exciting new project with Warner Brothers. During this tour, the first production meeting for the album occurred, with the trio of Holdsworth, Eddie Van Halen, and Ted Templeman getting together at Eddie's house to discuss plans and trade ideas for this new project. And sadly, this initial production meeting was where things began to go south. Over the next few months, the trio, along with other executives at Warner Brothers, had several meetings to discuss the album. But it became quickly apparent that the record company and even Allan's trusty friend, Eddie Van Halen, had two very different ideas of what the album should be. The record company's original plan for the album was for it to have an all-star cast of famous and well-known bassists, drummers, and even to have Eddie Van Halen guest on several tracks and trade solos with Allan. Holdsworth was horrified at these ideas, before asserting that if Eddie were to play on it, he would merely be selling the public some more Van Halen songs, whereas Allan just simply wanted to do his own thing and do it his way. Despite these difficulties, Allan and Warner Brothers pressed on, but even getting a definitive date to start the project was a huge hurdle, as finding time when both Eddie Van Halen and Ted Templeman were free to work on the album was next to impossible. Aside from gigging, Allan then spent the rest of 1982 furiously trying to reach either Van Halen or Templeman over the phone to get a start date for the project, often spending weeks at a time trying to get hold of either of them, before a start date of Christmas 1982 was initially set. After another cancellation, however, the date was moved to April 1983, with Eddie being unavailable, leaving just Templeman and Holdsworth to work on the album, to which Holdsworth reluctantly agreed. Then, just 2 days before these sessions were due to begin, Holdsworth received a phone call from Templeman, with Templeman once again cancelling and suggesting another date. This was the final straw for Holdsworth, as at this point it was nearly 12 months since Templeman had agreed to sign Allan after the gig in Reseda in May of 1982. And Holdsworth in that moment decided that he couldn't wait any longer and would press on and start the album alone, massively angering and upsetting Ted Templeman, Warner Brothers, and Eddie Van Halen, who was in South America touring with Van Halen at the time. The band then entered Music Grinder Studios on Hollywood Boulevard to begin cutting what would become Road Games. Problems arose immediately, however, as without Eddie or Ted there, Warner Brothers had no real idea what was going on and were worried that the project was about to go off the rails. The album opens with Three Sheets to the Wind, and within the first few seconds we are introduced to the new direction, style, and sound of this album. All of the songs on the album feature a much more definite and easily discernible, almost pop-like structure, unlike any of the tracks on his previous IOU album. Also, because of the album's bigger budget, we get to hear Holdsworth's guitar tonal vision in full for the very first time, as the album features extensive guitar overdubs, chordal swells, and harmonies. The song is also a perfect introduction to the new IOU band, with Chad Wackerman and Jeff Berlin both weaving their intricate playing around Holdsworth's majestic swells and soloing. The album's title track, Road Games, then follows, which was initially developed from an improvisation from Chad Wackerman's audition, and is probably, in my opinion, the closest Holdsworth ever came to straight-ahead rock or pop music, as the chorus is incredibly catchy and simple and accessible. One of the biggest points of contention between Warner Brothers, Ted Templeman, and Allan Holdsworth was the vocals on the album. As with the previous album, IOU's fourth man, the trusty Paul Williams, was set to handle the vocals. But there was one slight problem, as Ted Templeman hated Paul Williams' vocals. Warner Brothers were also unimpressed, wanting a vocalist with much more star power in order to sell the album, with Warner Brothers and Ted suggesting the likes of Geddy Lee from Rush to handle the vocals on the album. Because of these difficulties, the sessions for the album quickly became a nightmare for all involved. And after a few days' work at a time, the band would be frequently pulled out of the studio in order for Templeman and Warner Brothers to listen to what they had done. Most of the time listening back over the phone in order to approve everything before allowing the band back into the studio to continue with the album, with Allan even being declined the use of his own engineer in favour of a hand-picked audio engineer working under and directly answering to Ted Templeman. The album's third song, Water on the Brain Part 2, was originally recorded for the IOU album with a vocal from Paul Williams, but was left off the album due to a mishap with the tapes, and reworked as an instrumental for Road Games to include an absolutely killer bass solo from Jeff Berlin, showing off his impeccable timing, tone, and technique, producing a solo so well-paced and played that it easily goes toe-to-toe with any of Allan's guitar solos on the album. Considered at first to be a child prodigy on the violin, Jeff Berlin switched to bass aged 14, before studying at the prestigious Berklee College of Music in Boston, Massachusetts, before being discovered by Yes and King Crimson's Bill Bruford, who at the time was putting together his all-star band for his solo trilogy Feels Good to Me, One of a Kind, and Gradually Going Tornado, with Jeff playing alongside Holdsworth on the first two albums. Tokyo Dream track 4 is a personal favourite of mine, and shows off what a masterful orchestra and arranger Allan was on the guitar, and what Allan could accomplish with more time and a bigger budget. As this song features so many little guitar overdubs and sounds, some created with a pedal steel guitar, volume pedal swells, and pitch shifters, all perfectly gelling together to create beautiful fusion soundscapes invoking sonic images of Japan. Holdsworth at this point had been a long-time admirer of Japan and Japanese culture, and during his days struggling to get gigs in London, he began to notice a group of Japanese people in the audience who always really loved his music, and always imagined that if he could get the band over to Japan, they would do really well over there. Holdsworth then wrote this tune as a homage to those fans and the country he dreamed of visiting one day. And for all you gearheads out there, Allan's rig on this album had changed quite significantly since IOU, as he struck up a friendship with guitar luthier Grover Jackson, who ended up making Allan four Stratocaster-shaped Charvel guitars from various woods, with wider necks near the headstock similar to Gibson guitars, along with Gibson string spacing and Seymour Duncan pickups, with Allan at the time calling these the best guitars he'd ever owned. To create the album's luscious tones and delay lines, Allan used his trusty Hartley Thompson amplifiers with Yamaha cabs for his leads, and his Norlin Lab Series L5 amps, and a whole plethora of digital delays, including Yamaha, Lexicon, Dynacord, and AMS units to create the lush chordal swells and overdubs that are scattered throughout the album. Track 5 was there, apart from being an excellent demonstration of Chad Wackerman's drum chops, also features the album's main lead vocalist. After endless arguments with Ted Templeman and Warner Brothers about picking a singer, and Ted Templeman listening to several singers over the phone, Allan suggested his old bandmate and friend from his short-lived band, referred to by fans as Sherwood Forest in 1979, who recorded an often bootlegged demo tape of some of the material that would end up on IOU, and was rumoured to have been made to send to record companies to gain interest in Holdsworth's solo career. The singer and bassist on that demo tape was none other than Cream bassist and vocalist Jack Bruce, who aside from being an excellent vocalist had the all-important star power for Warner Brothers and Ted Templeman to be satisfied with for selling road games. Jack's vocals are a surprisingly good fit for Holdsworth and Company's fusion-y mastery, and Jack does even sound surprisingly similar to Paul Williams, making Ted Templeman's distaste for Williams even more of an enigma. The album closes with what is fast becoming one of my favourite Allan Holdsworth compositions, Material Real, beginning with some of Holdsworth's chordal swells before developing into an almost poppy vocal-led piece. Material Real, like everything else on the album for me, is a really interesting blend, bringing out much of Holdsworth's rock and pop influences infused with the style of his earlier works. And I feel it's a style that sadly, after this album and maybe a bit of the next album, he would never quite revisit again. Chad and Jeff also really shine on this, and the end sequence with its chordal swells is one of the most brilliant moments in Holdsworth's entire discography. The rest of the recording sessions for the album, by all accounts, were an absolute nightmare, as Ted Templeman would often listen to different takes over the phone to approve them, and when the time came for him to actually hear what the band had done, he was less than satisfied. And due to his dislike of the drum sound, all of the tracks for the album had to be entirely re-recorded from scratch to be more to his liking, much to the utter dismay of Allan and the band. After all of the tracks that ended up on the album had been recorded and Warner Brothers and Ted Templeman were suitably satisfied, then came the issue of the album's mix, which was once again a huge source of conflict between Allan, Warner Brothers, and Ted Templeman. Halfway through the mixing sessions at Music Grinder, under the insistence of Ted Templeman, the project was moved to Studio Amiga, a studio Holdsworth hated the sound of, Whilst at Studio Amiga, another famous Warner Brothers band were having problems with their tape machine, and rather than just rent another tape machine, much to the annoyance and protest of Allan, the multi-tracks of Road Games the band had been slaving away on were then transferred onto a 3M digital tape recorder, so that the other, more famous Warner Brothers band could use the tape machine Allan was working on. This process sadly also degraded and destroyed the sound quality of these pristine multitracks Allan and the band had been slaving away on. It was during this time that Chad Wackerman introduced Allan to a longtime admirer and fan of his, Frank Zappa. After explaining to Zappa everything that had gone on at Warner Brothers, Frank kindly offered Allan the use of his studio and his engineer to remix the remaining three songs. This, like everything else with Road Games, seemed to be a near impossible struggle, as Allan had to sneak into the studio behind the back of Warner Brothers and smuggle out the tapes. Once at Frank's studio, the damage done to the tapes from transferring them to the 3M digital tape recorder was immediately obvious. Despite this, Frank's engineer, Mark Pinsk, mixed three songs in one evening to Holdsworth's liking. Sadly though, these mixes were not used on the album, as Ted Templeman would not approve them for use. After returning to Studio Amiga and finishing off the mixes, some of which Allan had to pay for out of his own pocket, Allan sent off the now completed album to Warner Brothers and Ted Templeman for approval. It was during these final mixes Allan felt guilty and conflicted about the album. And although he was happy with Jack Bruce's vocals on a technical level on the album, he was gutted that Paul Williams, the writer of the lyrics and vocal melodies for the songs, didn't feature anywhere on the album. So at the very last minute, Allan switched the mixes of the title track Road Games to the version with Paul Williams on before submitting the album for approval. Deeming his friendship and alliance with Paul, who let's not forget gave Allan and the band a place to live when they came over to the States, more important than the fame or fortune Warner Brothers would bring him. Ted Templeman was absolutely fuming when he heard Williams' vocals on the title track, telephoning Allan and the band whilst they were on tour, exclaiming, "That's it, you're fired from the label." In the end, Ted calmed down and approved the album for release, later telling Allan's manager that he only approved it because he felt sorry for Allan and the band. Ted wasn't the only person unhappy with the results. Eddie Van Halen was also deeply disappointed, saying this about it in a Guitar World interview from 1990. He begins by recounting the story of the scheduling conflicts and Van Halen's South American tour and says, "Then, I hate to say this, while we were on tour in South America, he just didn't want to wait, like 2 weeks, you know? So he did it himself, and it ended up being just another Allan Holdsworth record. The guy needs direction, you know what I mean? So he blew it, I think. I really think I could have, well, not necessarily pulled him back, but steered him in a different direction, you know. I was just over at my friend Steve Lukather's house and he played me Allan's new record, and I tell you, I couldn't tell the difference between that and his other records. I don't want to rag on the guy because he's an incredible player and he's a good friend, I love him. He just needs direction, that's all." Even Allan was deeply dissatisfied and unhappy with Road Games. Here's a collection of quotes from Allan about the album. "That album I hated. That record was a disaster. I really didn't like it at all. It was a disaster on wheels, you know. It was not good. I see it as one of the worst records I've ever made. I don't like anything about it. It was Warner Brothers trying to mold me into something I'm not. But on the other hand, it was sonically awful." In one quote, however, he does relent and reflects, "But there is some good playing on it. Chad and Jeff play great on it." Road Games was eventually released in mid-1983, with differing dates according to different sources, including the 17th of May, which sounds about right given the timeline of events. It was dubbed by Warner Brothers a specially priced six-cut mini-album, and received favourable reviews from guitar magazines, and even earned Allan his only ever Grammy nomination for Best Rock Instrumental Performance in 1984. Which he lost to Sting. Sadly though, sales of the album were very lackluster, and due to all of the fighting between Allan, Ted, and Warner Brothers, Allan was dropped from the label. Despite Allan's criticism of the album, it has since become a fan favourite and is one of his most accessible and, in my opinion, one of his best albums. Now, so far, Ted Templeman has been painted as a very dark character in this video. And in the interests of making this video well-balanced and not completely one-sided, I must tell Ted Templeman's version of events that he recounted in his 2020 autobiography, Ted Templeman, A Platinum Producer's Life in Music. I'll start off by reading how he remembers the very first production meeting. Ted writes, "So we all sat down and Ed spoke about playing on the record and his ideas for songs. I offered up my take too. Allan said, well, okay. First off though, I have a request. Ed and I both nodded and said, okay, sure. I don't want you guys in the studio with me, said Allan. What? Templeman replied. Allan continued, I want you guys to produce me, but not be in the studio while I'm recording. The trio then continued talking, then after Allan left, Ted continues, all we could do is shake our heads and laugh, because honestly, all you could do was laugh. After that, things got worse. He fought me every step of the way. We clashed on everything from his band lineup to his musical direction. The whole thing turned out to be a giant headache. I left Holdsworth to his own devices in the studio much of the time, because working with him was so difficult. Rather than doing an album, Warner Brothers released the project as an EP called Road Games. It sank without a trace upon release. Now, who you choose to believe here, whether it be Allan or Ted, is entirely up to you. And to wrap up the video, here's a poignant and interesting quote from Allan about the whole experience. You make decisions at certain points in your life as to what you want to do. Things have been offered to me where I could have done something commercial and earned a lot more money and been really miserable. I'd rather be broke and happy than miserable and rich. So all I'm trying to do is get by. Just a musician's dream, really. To be able to play what I'd like to play and be able to survive. That's my dream." Thanks for watching The Making of Road Games by Allan Holdsworth. I really wasn't sure about making this video at first, but the story was just so gripping and interesting that I felt like I had to give it a go. Thanks for watching, and I hope to see you all again very soon.